Let's welcome Pastor James Hill.
His goodness today, and we want to say that it's a blessing to be here today. Amen. We just thank God for the service to this point, and we just want to keep on doing all that we do to the glory of God. I'm really blessed with the ministry of the praise and worship team.
Amen.
And we're asking them to continue on doing good. They want good work. Aren't they doing good work? All right. Do we have anybody out there who would like to join the singing group? Do we have any? I see one hand back there. Okay. Actually, we're going to go on record that we want Sister Tia. See, all of this adds a whole lot to the service. When we can get Sister Dorothy, you know, we don't want anybody sitting on gifts, powerful gifts.
Amen.
And we're going to be looking for Sister Dorothy to do it once a month, twice a month, at least once a month. How many here the last Sunday? How many were blessed?
Amen.
And how many were here to Sister Dorothy?
Amen.
More?
Amen.
You think she's sitting there on a powerful gift? All right, now we're going to ask Sister Tia. Y'all tell her.
Yeah.
Amen. I don't want to have to tell you at the last minute that today you're going to be singing. But all of this adds, if everybody just used what they have,
yeah,
it would just be so much better. Amen. And so we just want to say that we just want God to be glorified and to magnify. I got something that everybody are going to be able to help you with. I'm really impressed with the commitment that we're getting from our different ones that really have a desire to help with new members and those coming into the kingdom of God that need to be taught the word of God. I'm going to ask Sister Angela to stand. Sister Angela Mason. So the angel looking around. It's not another one in here. Okay. Now, Sister Angela is a kind of a different person. She has a lot in her, and she's going to be really used of God. I want you to, first of all, start out with a Bible study in your home. I want you to have all your family there, because we got to figure out how we can get your teenager and your son, everybody in a Bible study. I don't know how we're going to do it, but that just started in your house. And I believe that Brother Dwayne, all right, you will be able to persuade him, all right? So you should be at least four adults. And you call me, let me know the best time to do it. And from that point, we will get somebody to help you with that Bible study in your house. But I'm going to start it out. And I know if it can be done, you can do it. All right. And she comes on Wednesday, and she's very interested. And I'm really proud of her. And the Lord is really using her. The gifts of the Spirit are beginning to work in her life. And we're just going to really open the door for God to do whatever He wills to do in their life. Now, all right, y'all let me know. It's got to happen this week. All right. She'll do it. She'll get the job done. All right. And we got Sister Wayne and Sister Pearl. No, Sister Pearl is not coming on Wednesday morning, but she's here Wednesday night. But Sister Wayne, she has aspiration. She has a powerful ministry. And if she's not here on Wednesday morning, it just don't seem right. So she's the one that calls everybody to make sure everybody's in place. And Sister Elam, Sister Yvonne, And we're gonna hold all of y'all responsible for y'all's people, those prospects, those people that came a couple weeks ago. And we're gonna hold y'all accountable for corralling them. So Yvonne, so you might be able to have a Bible study in your house, get your family together. We gotta start somewhere, right? Amen. So maybe I'll give Sister Yvonne the same assignment. You got them here on Sunday. See if you can get them all together at your house. Amen. You should be able to get 6 or 8 of them some kind of way. All right. And so Sister Holman, she's going to stand for us. They were here, Sister Holman and Sister Denise were here Friday evening. And they were here supporting the new, the prospects and the visitors, those that had visited, and those that were interested in Bible study. And they have been very instrumental in getting people in place. And I know that we won't have to worry about them. Amen. So we just really praise God for Sister Marianne. Where's Sister Marianne? Where's Sister Marianne standing? All right, she's got a little group of people that she's going to work on. Keep on working, keep on working, keep on working. And I think that we're going to have these Bible studies ready for all of you that's going to have be working with people so that you can do individual work with them at your convenience. On the phone, you can meet with them, you can do whatever, but we're going to have those Bible studies set up where you can actually do those studies independent of anybody else. Amen. So we want everybody to know that, and we are going to expect more and more of you to get involved. Now, shame on you if you don't come to a Bible study at all. Shame. Amen. Because this is how you're going to get equipped to minister to people that you are interested in helping to get established in the kingdom of God. Amen. How many believe it's time for all of us to get involved and not just a few? Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. All right. We're going to have a word of prayer, and we're going to pray that God will stir us, God will awaken us, and God will put in us all that we need in order for us to be effective in carrying out the work that he has assigned us. Father, we thank you today. We give you praise. We give you the glory. In Jesus' name, Father, you who have begun the good work within us, you who have begun the good work, you shall continue to perform it. Father, our eyes are on you. You're the author and the finisher of our faith. And we know that you're faithful and promise, and we'll hold fast to our confession of faith without wavering, because we know that you are faithful. Father, we thank you today for your grace. For your grace is sufficient, and you're able to cause all grace to abound to us, so we will have sufficiency in everything. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said together, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
All right. I want to continue to work on this particular subject, God's purpose for your life, God's purpose for your life. And we're going to work with very closely with new members, or new prospects, and those that's trying to get established in the Lord. Because we want them coming into the ministry with the purpose of being equipped to carry the gospel to those that's closest to them, to their loved ones, to their families, to their spouses, to their children, and want to see all teenagers. And we're going to get a group of teenagers meeting as soon as we can sort through a few things. But we want all teenagers in all homes, we want them reached by the gospel as well. And I think every teenager deserves somebody in their house, or somebody that have a heart for them, teaching them and helping them to get established in the things of God. You know, I would hate to have a teenager myself that have gotten to the point, they're 15, 16, 17, or even 12 or 13, and they are not established and they are not really equipped to deal with life and even not able to make the right choices. I think every child deserves to have a background in the Word of God. Woe unto them. Woe. Facing life, all of the sin and all of the iniquity and all that Satan is doing and all of the perversion and all of the drug traffic and all of the ungodly things that's existing today. I would hate to have a child to go through all of that. And I know in high schools, and I know that you don't find too many teenagers really have a fear of God. I mean, I imagine some of them, y'all hear some of them cursing. And I understand some of them are having sex in the restrooms. And pornography and all of these damnable things. And yet they don't have a clue as to their purpose in this life. They have no defense. Nothing to shield and to protect them from the evil devices that's coming in from so many different ways. Amen. So we just want to get concerned about our family. Lord, I don't see how y'all, amen, those that got children, how could you be content not really wanting the fear of God? I mean, not really doing all that you can. So this is the motivation for you to come, parents. You need to come, and the Bible says that it's God's will for all men to be what? Saved. Amen. And come to the what? Knowledge of the truth.
Yes.
That's God's will.
That's right.
And our homes need the fear of God. We need some type of a weapon, a defense.
Yes.
Amen. That we can wage against what? The enemy who's coming to steal, kill, and what? Destroy. Amen. So we need that. And our heart is that God will raise up leaders, God will raise up workers, God will raise up willing workers that will be willing to carry the gospel and help families to get established in what? The Word of God. And that's what we are actually starting with. Amen. God's plan for your life. Well, we're going to just lay it out and everybody will know what God's plan is for your life. Amen. We can, at least people need to know the plan of God. Amen. And begin to what? Take God's purpose for your life, what? Very serious. Amen. Praise God. So that's what I feel like is going to be very important. And I also, this is going to be the first area of that we're going to communicate to people. The importance of understanding God's purpose for your life. I believe if we knew God's purpose for your life, then we wouldn't be so inclined to what? To want to live our lives the way that we want to live.
All right.
Amen. Many times our lives are lived just to please what? Ourselves.
All right.
Amen. To satisfy our what? Carnal emotions. Our sexual, desires. And the works of, the lust of our own flesh. Amen. So these are going to be some of the things that we're going to communicate to our leaders and to all of those of you that will come so that you can be instrumental in getting the Word of God established in your family, your home, your relative, in the lives of your loved ones, and whosoever will, as the scripture says, let him come. All right. Also, in the area of man's condition before God, everybody needs to know, without Christ, where you're standing. I mean, your life is in a precarious position. I mean, it's just a real huge risk. And you need to understand your destiny without Christ. You need to understand what's going to happen. I was talking to Brother Jonathan. I mean, I was surprised he grew up in the church. And he's the Lord is really dealing with him. And, you know, for the first time in a long time, I can see a sincerity in him. Because the Lord is beginning to what? Warn. And I was talking with him about 30 minutes. You know, he wanted to talk with me, and he is making a commitment to start coming so that he can get where he needs to be in the Lord. And he even mentioned, I mean, I asked him so many questions, and I was just alone. Every question I asked him, almost he knew it because he was raised in the church. So now it's a time for him to come to grips with what he knows. And he knows that. And I can see a real change of our heart in his life at this point. So y'all are going to be seeing a whole lot more gentlemen. I'm going to make them accountable to me. And I want to do the same thing for a whole lot of the other teenagers. I want to establish a relationship with them and meet with them and begin to share with them foundational things. I used to be a school teacher. I taught 7th grade, 8th grade, 9th grade, 10th grade, 11th grade, 12th grade. And I even taught up in college. Amen. So I can relate to where you are and what's going on with you. And of course, I helped to raise Robert didn't do as much as Sister Hill, but at least I was at the house. One thing I always did, I did a whole lot of cooking. I remember that. And he used to tell me, "Oh, Dad, I always had food ready." yes, my wife wanted me to clarify that because she was working at 5 o'clock. I was getting up at 3:30. I was a school teacher. All right. All right, I just wanted to really deal with families this morning because, oh gosh, I know that the thing that's needed most in families and homes now is a knowledge of the Word.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. How many know that without a knowledge, our kids have no direction? I mean, just keep on going the way, the Bible says there's a way that seemeth what? Right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of what? Death. And I don't think anybody want to go down that path leading to death. Alright, when we say that there's a way that seemeth right unto a man, the end thereof are the ways of death, that doesn't mean that just regular dying physically. Because everybody is appointed unto all men to what? To die. But after death, then what? The judgment. There is something that we call a second death. And nobody knows about it because many times we weren't reared in church. Second death means that there's going to be a death that will be eternal. That is, after you die naturally, then you will experience a second death. That means eternity alienated from God. This is going to be a time in which you will pay for your rejection of Christ. That's what we mean by second death. You will pay. In other words, you will have to give an account of all of the deeds. And God will judge you according to the knowledge that you have and the opportunities that you have to really get amen, into what harmony with his plan for your life. He will judge you. The Bible says that they, the judgments and the punishment that would occur will be in different phases. In other words, it will be in different degrees. People that knew God's will and what didn't do it, they're going to be what measured by what? A higher standard. See, there are a lot of people that know a lot more than they what do.
All right.
Scripture says, he that knoweth to do good and don't do it, to him is what? Sin. So, the degree that you will suffer in eternity, that's called the second death, will depend on the amount of knowledge that you have, the amount of light that you have. And then it also depends on the works that you did, the things you did in your body. See, so that's the reason why we always tell people that the thing that God is looking for is what? To fear Him and to keep His commandments.
Yes, amen.
That's the reason why you're here. Fear God, keep His commandments. This is the whole duty of man. For God will bring into judgment every work along with every what? Secret thing. See, God knows all of the secrets, all of the hidden things of darkness. All of the things that you've thought about doing, all of the things, the sins you've done internally, God already has a record of all of that. And I think that everything that taken place in your body, I think everybody ought to have a desire to get it all what? Erased out.
All right.
I mean, just take back everything that you did. I mean, just have your past record completely wiped out.
Amen.
Amen. So that's what you want done.
Yes.
And in this life, so that's the reason why the Bible says that that God has what made it possible. Jesus, who knew no sin, became what sin for us, that we might be made what the righteousness of God. See, God wants that completely turned around. He wants your ungodly lifestyle completely what eradicated. See, God is willing to all of the sins as far as the east is from the west. He wants to what? Remove your sins from you.
Yes. All right.
And that's what remission of sin is all about. I mean, to what? Give you a clean slate.
Yes.
Then after you get a clean slate, you need to do what? Talk the word.
Yes.
Amen. I'm not understanding what I'm saying.
Amen.
You need to be what? Talk the word. Amen. So that you won't be what? Committing the same sins over and over. See, remission removes what? All of the sins you ever done from the time of accountability to the time that you receive Christ as your Lord and Savior.
Amen.
See, remission removes what? Everything. And then what happens after you get them all wiped out if you keep on sinning? So when you keep on sinning after you get them all wiped out, you better what? Do something about it.
Amen.
Somebody said, amen, be sure your sins will what? Find you out.
That's right.
Amen. But forgiveness will kick in. In other words, you can get any sin that you commit forgiven just by, if scripture says, if you confess your sins.
Amen.
Amen. But God doesn't mean for you to use that as a what? As an excuse for what? Just keep on doing it. And keep on what? Asking Him to what? Remove it. God is not in that kind of business. Mm-hmm. So that's the reason why you have to what? Study to show yourself a what? Approved unto God. You have to what? Get a knowledge of God's will. You have to what? Understand what God's will is. The Bible says, be not ignorant of God's will. Amen. Be understanding of what God's will is.
Yes.
See, God wants every man to be what? Saved and come to the what? Knowledge.
Amen.
And you can't get a knowledge of God's will if you're not willing to what? To make a sacrifice and come to hear the word. That's the biggest mistake many times people make, because many times people haven't grown up in environments where they are used to coming to church. And every other Sunday is okay with them. Whenever somebody what put pressure on them, it's all right with them. If it's just Easter, Christmas, and whatever. Amen. But it's for your benefit, because it's God's will for you to be what? Saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. And you can what? You can live a life pleasing to God if you're willing what? Amen. To what? Obey Him. If you're willing to what? To get something in you. And it won't happen automatically. It's not going to be easy to get free from pornography. I remember it was a young lady that used to work with, come here for ministry, and she was married to her husband was a pastor, and he got really hooked on pornography. And I see these are the identities that nothing can break except the power of God. There are a whole lot of addictions.
Right. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
I'm not, amen.
All right.
Amen. If you about the works of the flesh and all of these things that got people tripped up and messed up to the enemy, amen, he wants to what? Tie a real, what? He wants to put a noose around all of our what? Lives. Amen. He wants to what? Ensnare us and bring us into captivity to him. He wants to call the shots for our life and make us do whatever he wants us to do.
Yes.
See, the enemy, somebody said he's a dirty fighter. He's a dirty fighter. Somebody said, amen, amen. Don't let the devil ride. He's trying to flag everybody down. And see who will what? Take. Amen. Trying to stop people and what? Offer them, amen, a more exciting, pleasurable life. Amen. But somebody said, don't let him, he might be waving and trying to what? Flag you down, but don't stop. And don't let him what? Don't let him ride. You know, sometimes the devil makes you feel, if I could just ride just a little piece, I ain't going to hurt nobody. I ain't going to cause no problems. Everything is going to be all right. Just let me ride. Just take me up 2 or 3 blocks. Oh, Lord Jesus. But the problem with that, when you let him in, if you give him an inch, he'll take a mile. You know what? Don't let him ride, because if you let him ride, he's going to want to what? He's going to want to drive. Then you have to what? Go where he wants you to go. Do what he wants you to do. So the Bible says what? Don't even give him a place. Don't give him no room. Don't open the door. Amen. The way that you can keep the devil at bay, you got to have some what? Knowledge. You got to have some what? Information, right? You got to know the ways of God. You got to know the ways of what? The enemy.
Yes.
Because there's a way that seems right, but the end there, the devil will lead you right down to that what? Amen. To that sort of point of death. And he can have you, making you feel like what? He's your friend. He gets you out on the limb, right? And cut the limb off. And you say, oh, Mr. Devil, you didn't ditch me like that, did you? You didn't just let me fall. He said, well, you know I'm the devil. You fool. You can't listen to the devil. You can't play his game, because he'll end up what? Winning everything. He's been around a lot longer than you. He knows all the tricks in the trade. So you don't want to mess with stuff, you know, because, I know this preacher I was mentioning about, a pastor, had a nice family, raised a child. He started, watching the devil's program on the internet. A porno. You know, it's a multi-billion-dollar industry. The devil got a whole lot of suckers, I said, takers. Because he knows if he can get them hooked, all he has to do is just feed them just a little bit of bait. They don't need but a little bit. And I said, just a little dab to do it. Like grill cream, bro. Just a little dab to do it. See, that's the reason why it's important for us to come into homes and share the gospel with these families. Yeah. Because these families, they ain't got, a lot of them ain't done nothing to their children in terms of what? Preparing them what?
Yes.
How to stand against the wiles of the enemy.
Yes, amen.
And we got some real powerful weapons at our disposal if we can, what, get you interested in what, using them. Bible says the weapons of our warfare are not what? Carnal, but they are what?
Mighty.
Through God. Mighty what? Through God. Amen. To the pulling down the strongholds. See, we need to hear the truth in our homes. Our children need to hear the what? Truth. We don't want to leave, amen, leave a poor example around them. Because guess what? Kids are going to what? Live out what they what? See taking place in the home. If there's no respect in the home, amen, then what? They're going to walk that out. Can't get blood out of a turn. That's the reason why we got to what? Do our job. We can't do our job without Christ. We can't do our job without a knowledge of the truth. We can't do our job in our families and our homes if we are not what? Really concerned about the destiny of those that's what? Closest to us. Amen. Now, I started out talking about second death. Second death is alienation from God forever. I mean, my people can't even conceive of that. I can't even, amen, probably the best I could do to try to get you to understand how serious the second death is. If I could explain it perfectly, I still would fall short of trying to get over to you the destiny of those that die without Christ. I mean, it is going to be a horrible thing. Amen. And so we just want you to know that Jesus came to seek and to save them that are what? Lost. Amen. Came to seek and to what? Save those that are lost. And God doesn't have any, this is what God said. He says, I have no interest in the death of the wicked. I don't want nobody to die a horrible death without Christ, because they know God. A person knows that if a person dies without Christ, amen, the first thing they do, pay the penalty for sin. In other words, the price for rejecting Christ starts immediately after one leaves this earth scene. The penalty for sin starts immediately. In other words, spirit, soul, body. People should be able to relate to the triune, you know, aspect of man. Everybody has a physical body. And I think that most people love their body. Everybody always in the mirror. They love themselves. Amen. They always want to what? Please themselves. Do whatever what? Satisfy their what? Their desires. I mean, we were talking a little bit about Friday evening. You learned a whole lot of things in the Bible study. We were talking about the works of the flesh that causes God to disinherit you. They will not inherit the kingdom of God. They won't go to heaven. I'm talking about the second death. Now, they will end up at that scenario where they will receive the sentence of what? The second death. Now, second death, as I said, alienation from God, away from God forever. Not a million, jillion, quintillion, sextillion, hextillion. I mean, that's forever. That's after you stand before the white throne judgment. I don't think anybody's going to stand before the white throne judgment, because that's a judgment that every person that rejected Christ is going to get up out of the grave, or he's going to come out of hell. Get out of the grave. Come up out of the grave. See, everybody that lives, so I'm just talking things that everybody should know, but there's no way you can know them if you, amen, haven't really, you know, been, you know, in the Word. Every person that rejects Christ, that refuses to live for Christ, they will make their appearance. They will be resurrected. Everybody will be resurrected one way or the other. Whether you are living for Christ or whether you are not living for Christ, you will be resurrected. In other words, you're going to live in a body again after you die. See, if you die now, How many don't want to die? You know, a whole lot of people talking about heaven. Everybody talking about heaven don't want to die. Everybody don't want to go to heaven, but nobody want to what? Die. That's the last thing people want to do. They ain't ready. I don't care how miserable your life is. I don't care what you're going through. I don't care what kind of situation is happening in your life. You don't want to die. Because most people, they're not sure what's going to happen to them. They don't know whether they're going to end up at the judgment seat or whether they're going to end up at the white throne. Judgment seat is good news even if you didn't do everything that you should do if you finally, you know, get your life together and get in by the skin of your teeth. Some people will survive, will go back with Jesus just by the skin of their teeth. You know, some people that get saved at the last minute, on that deathbed, dying bed, most people are going to have, you know, most people, they know if they're about to leave here, they're going to try to get what stuff right.
Amen.
Yeah. Right. Y'all seen anybody? Amen. You don't find nobody, everybody is serious when the doctor says, 3 months.
Come on.
Come on. I don't think anybody's trained. People get serious. Amen. But the judgment, talk to somebody said, the judgment seat of Christ. What is that? Ask me, what is the judgment seat of Christ? What is the judgment seat of Christ? The Bible says that ye all will have to stand, I mean, these are all Christians, all believers will have to stand before the judgment seat of Christ to give an account of all of the what? Deeds done in your body. See, teenagers need to know that. Teenagers know that those that do not appear at the judgment seat of Christ, that means that you can be involved in an accident and your spirit and soul will go down or go up.
Alright.
Look how y'all looking at me. You can be involved. See, you're here today, you don't have no power over your life. Now, if you in faith, you can what? Decree things, and the law of faith can what? Supersede anything the devil wants to do, and the devil can't snatch you out of here before what? You get ready.
Amen.
I mean, can say amen.
That's right.
But if your spirit and soul, everybody says spirit and soul. Some of y'all say, well, what is a spirit and soul? Spirit and soul is the thing that is a spirit part of you, the inside part of you. Spirit and soul. Everybody say spirit and soul.
Spirit and soul.
All right. I'm not doing no deep teaching today, but I think that this is the kind of thing that new members are, people that's really just beginning to get serious about the Lord, they need to what? They need to understand.
Amen.
Spirit and soul.
Amen.
Is a part of you that makes you what? A living being.
That's right.
If your spirit and soul left your body, that's like being involved in an accident and you are so messed up, then your spirit and soul say, I'm gonna get out of here. That means that they're going to come out of your body. Mm. And if they come out of your body, then you're dead. Graveyard dead, 6 feet under dead. Mm-hmm. You're bombing through it dead.
Come on.
That means your body will go down off your up. If you saved, your body will go down to the grave. Your spirit will go up.
Amen. Amen.
And you want to make sure that you're living a life. If something happens, you never know.
You never know.
See, people take the biggest risk on their what? The most important possession that they have. There is nothing about you that's important as your what? Your spirit and soul.
Amen.
And that's the part of you that what? The part that most people are not what? Concerned about. The part of your physical body, the part that you always want to what? Satisfy. Oh, I got to feel good. I want to what? Get my thrill. I want to, the Bible says pleasure. I want to get my pleasure. The pleasures of sin are just for what?
A season.
And the problem is that, that whenever you are living in sin, you are living, the Bible says, they that are living in pleasure are dead while they live. Mm-hmm. Y'all understand that? They're dead while they live. How can you be dead and still living?
Come on.
How can you be dead while you live? There's a whole lot of what living dead for. That simply means that what? You're living outside of God's plan. You're out of fellowship. You're out of touch. You're out of what? Out of grace. That's a bad place, because if you're dead while you live, if you die for real, physically, then you face what? Second death. And that's how the devil, what? He traps you, and he traps you with what? Using pleasure. And the pleasure of sin is only for a season. Just think about those millions. I was a math teacher. I can count big. What comes after million? Billion. What comes after billion? Trillion. Y'all pretty good too. What comes after trillion? Quadrillion, right? Quad, then quin, then sex, then hexillion. Octillion, whatever. Okay, so that means that when a person is sentenced to death, the Bible says that the only one that will be spared of second death are those that take place, those that arise in the what? First resurrection. See, believers won't have to face the second death. They're going to be what? Reigning with Christ. They're going to be what? Living with the Lord forever throughout eternity. They will be serving God there. They're like serving God throughout eternity. We will have what? Roles and positions, responsibilities. We will be what? Amen, praise God, working with Christ throughout eternity. But it depends on what we do here.
Come on.
Amen. See, life is nothing more than a time of probation that you prove to God the true you. See, God knows who you are before you even start, right? But he wants you to what? Walk it out so he can what? Have it at the judgment and say, look here, this is what you did. Here's your life on.
Glory to God.
I got it on here.
Come on.
God knows what you're going to do, but then God needs a what? Track record of your what? Your nature, your personality, and your what? Your attitude. He wants, because see, that's going to determine what he can do with you in the next life. If you don't live with what the dog made here, then God, you can't be trusted with eternal responsibilities. That's the reason why we need help. Y'all guys want to agree with me? We need what? We need what? Direction. We need, you know, instead of y'all running from me,
come on.
You know, Pastor, you're trying to help people there. Figure out how they conduct me. Y'all know this is instigated by the devil, right? They trying to duck me. They don't want me to call them. Getting too close to home.
Say that.
See, Brother Travis Wednesday night, he gave us a real good illustration. If we had time, we would let him talk about it. He said that when he first got saved and filled with the Holy Spirit, he was living a common law relationship. He was living in a common law relationship. See, most people don't think nothing is wrong with nothing.
All right.
They don't think pornography is wrong. They don't think nothing is wrong. So that's the reason why the Bible says the devil has blinded our what? He don't want you to what? See the truth. He don't want you to know the truth, but it's God's will for you to what? To be saved and come to the knowledge of it. So God is doing everything he can to what? Get your eyes open. And he even told us to pray that what? People's eyes would be open to the truth.
Yes, Lord.
Are we praying?
Glory to God.
We have to pray.
Amen.
And Brother Trevor was saying, he said that when I got saved, I was living with I guess they've been living for years in a relationship. It's literally that we just decided we want to live. Oh, man, I mean, we can't get booked all that trouble. But we got, we might get in and we might not like it. If we don't get married, we know what? We don't like it, we know what? Get out of it.
Come on.
Amen. See, the only thing that's going to what, clean you up,
yes,
turn you, I mean, pick you up and turn you around is the Word of God.
Amen.
The Bible says the Word of God is calculated what? To clean you, make
yes,
you right.
Yes.
To put a fear of God in your what, life. How shall the, okay, Brother Travis, he said that when he got saved, he was living, had been living for years, I guess, in that relationship. And all of a sudden, his wife, I mean, she's the one that came in and got saved first. And when she got saved, then she said, no, we can't sleep together no more. See, she came and got the truth, see. The Word, see, you're clean, but we all be glad to hear the Word. It's trying to what? Save you from what? Second death.
Come on.
That's right. I don't think nobody wants to know what. If you can envision a sea of fire, a lake of fire, the Bible says it would be a lake of fire, like the Pacific Ocean. A Pacific Ocean, where is that? The Atlantic Ocean, the Pacific. Can you think of a whole ocean full of just liquid fire? Liquid fire, this fire, I mean, you're going to be cast in that cave, die or perish. You won't ever burn up. It's going to be more spirit soul. It's going to be what, spirit soul and body. Resurrection, get your body back. Everybody will get another body again after you die. And bro, his girlfriend who became his wife, she said, we ain't living together. I mean, we ain't, okay, I know we in this house together, but we don't want to sleep in separate beds. No more, no more, no more sin. Brother Travis said that struck him. I mean, that really got to him. And before long, he was marching down these aisles.
Amen.
Right. You're right. Right. Maybe they did the same bed, but no cohabitation, that's what he'll say, but that was established. And see, people think that God has no standards, he'll take anything, we can live any kind of way. We don't have to measure up to God's law, God's way. I can just what, do it the way I want to do it. I'm a man, can't nobody tell me what to do. Amen. See, that's where people make what? Their mistakes. And see, I'm going to tell you something here. Unless somebody takes an interest in you, and just like Sister Denise them came out the other day, 4:30, you know, that's messing up somebody's day. I mean, they had a whole lot of other stuff they could have done. Sister Mary Ann, she's a businesswoman. And I don't give her too much credit for being a housewoman. She's a digital professional. I give you an A+ on that. But she's interested in souls. I love it. And I think that this is something that all of us ought to be concerned about. Now, I don't see how you wouldn't want to place yourself in a position where you can help to keep people out of hell or out of prevent the second death, miss the second death. That's the reason why I'm asking Sister Angela, you got to do it. Amen. I'm looking at your daughter now. Amen. Praise God. Y'all have to do it. And I believe that y'all can understand that unless somebody takes time with you. Now, you tell me, find a church that you're going to find people willing to come like at 4:30,
come on.
5 o'clock in the morning. 7 o'clock on Wednesday night,
right.
And will actually call you up on the telephone and have a Bible study with you and pray with you. Find a church that will be committed to doing that until you get established. Find a people that will be willing to travail, Travail in the spirit until you are established in the Lord. Furniture. Now most churches, y'all know, you go to, and nobody, if it's a big church, nobody know you. And they ain't concerned about you. You might have a pastor or a staff. They might call or respond when you call them for some critical need. But you ain't going to find nobody that's willing to take up a whole lot of time on you without getting what? Something for it.
That's the truth.
Is that right? And you have all the opportunity to come on Wednesday morning. Now, Wednesday night is kind of hard for some people because it's raining. Yeah, Sister Wayne, you gotta make a way, but see, Sister Wayne, when she comes over, you know what she got in her mind? How I can take what you're teaching back out there and what have a Bible study with somebody else.
Amen.
So we said, well, Wednesday night is hard for everybody, so we just what do it on Wednesday morning. So I have to, you know, I have to make preparations. That takes all my morning almost. Okay, well, since they come and can't come on Wednesday night, we'll try Wednesday morning. Okay, well, we have a group coming on Wednesday morning. They bring people, they call people, they sit up here as long as I keep them. I was here, I need to see be right back. Until I said, amen, praise the Lord, amen, let's go. Then, Brother Travis said, well, maybe they can't come on Wednesday morning, night or Wednesday night. But I'll be here 5 o'clock on Tuesday morning. Amen, Brother Al. Is that right?
Amen.
And then we have another chance. Thursday morning, we said, well, suppose they can't come Monday night, they can't come Tuesday morning, they can't come Wednesday morning, they can't come Wednesday night. On Thursday morning, let them come again. And this time we'll do a Bible study with them. And you know, on all of these, you got people, you have people that don't take none of that. So they're not going to be able to help nobody. So I'm preaching to everybody today.
All right. Amen.
But here's the thing about it, you're going to have to give an account for all of this. All the opportunities, the time, the talents, the treasures, anything that God has given you to work with to help people, and you're not using it, that's going to come up at the judgment seat of Christ. You will have to what? You have to what? Answer for that. And that will mean what? A loss or the gain. I mean, it will mean you will receive a reward for your faithfulness, or it will be what? The rejection of a reward. See, a lot of people will probably get through by the skin of their teeth, but they won't have no rewards and nothing to show for 50 years of labor. 50 years of living. Can you think of that? People been here to do God's plan. You know, it's God's purpose for us to what? Glorify Him. It's His purpose for us to what? Take the place of Jesus. In other words, do what Jesus would do if He were here in what? Person. We're to what? Bring forth fruit, character fruit. See that? Up there, love, joy, peace, patience, care. We get to work at it until what? Those things are developed in us so people can see what? The living Christ in us. And that's the thing that what compels them, constrains them, to give them a desire and a motivation what, to come to Christ when they can see what? A person that's what? Walking it out.
Amen.
A person that's living their life.
Amen.
See, that's called the fruit of the Spirit. Then God wants you to what? He wants you to what? Bring forth fruit. In other words, He wants you to bring forth fruits of righteousness. Helping people. Blessing. Just like we opened the Word, praying for people, admonishing them, calling them, warning them. All of that are fruits that God wants us to what? Bring forth.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. How many understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
And the motivation for this, the reason why many times people don't do it is because many times people just don't what show up when they're supposed to show up. They don't want to cut nothing. They don't want to make no sacrifice. Y'all ever heard of people that, you know, I know Sister Hill, I understand this real well. Now, she's very beautiful at home. I mean, she don't like a messed up house. Ooh, Lord. I mean, I'm not such a stickler about everything being immaculate all the time. You know, I'm like, you know, leave my PJs on the, down in the middle of the floor. My socks could be all over the place. Amen. Well, I'm telling you, but Sister Hill, she wants everything in place. You do too?
Amen.
Yeah, I think a whole lot of y'all like that, huh?
Yep.
Poor brothers, let's start us a movement. Now, see, what happens is that she wants everything in place, and for me, I don't have to have everything. As long as I got my Bible and my little writings I like to do and all that. But here's the thing about it, is that we have to understand that we as people of God, we got to have our business in order. The Bible said, not being slothful in business, fervent in spirit, rejoicing in the Lord.
Yes.
Not slothful in what? Business. How many know soul winning business is a real business?
Amen.
Don't be slothful in business. Amen. Y'all looking down. Y'all looking sad. Y'all perked up. The good news is what? It's the power of God. Amen. But we're going to close out, but I just felt led today to share that with you so that y'all can really understand the reason why we make such sacrifice. We go as far as we can go to give people an opportunity to be what God wants them to be and to place themselves in a position where they can be a real force for God. I think God said we are ambassadors, we're workers together with Him,
yes.
And the assignment that Jesus gave to us when He ascended, amen, is the assignment that we've been delegated, and when He comes, He's going to hold us accountable. Amen. And I think that this is the motivation. I think that every person that beginning to reach out, make sure that you try to have those people in the seat on Sunday, on Wednesday. Amen. Because that's very, very important. How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right, everybody standing wherever you are. Amen. We're going to have communion today. We're going to pray. Hallelujah. We're going to pray. You need to be in God. Well, you can get that straight today. And you can participate in the Lord's Supper. We call it communion. All God wants you to do is to what? Acknowledge your sin. If you acknowledge your sin, confess it, and forsake it, the Lord will have what? He will have mercy. God doesn't want you to persist in sin because it's going to lead to what? Death. Second death. Alienation from God. And that is the reason why Jesus came and what? Made the sacrifice and became sin for us.
Amen.
Now I want everybody to know the story, the greatest story ever told. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son.
Amen.
So that whosoever what? Believeth in Him shall not what?
Perish.
But have what? Everlasting life. The only way you can have everlasting life is that you have to what? Believe on it. You have to get rid of your sins. You have to what? Confess your sins. You have to what? Say, Lord, I want my sins what? Wiped out. I want to be washed in your blood. I want to make a turn from darkness to light. And I want to have my inheritance among them that are sanctified. Amen. One day, you're going to be what? Wanted. what you have rejected. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. And I would like to see everybody to spend eternity in heaven. In the presence of God. Bible says God will wipe away all of our tears. I don't care how miserable, how difficult your life has been. God said he will wipe away all tears from your eyes. And those that overcome, the Bible says they will inherit all things. The Bible says that, hallelujah, we will become partakers of Christ if we hold fast our confidence steadfast all the way to the end. That's what we're here for. We'll help you to what? Get a grip on God. And we're going to what? Help you to what? Get established in the things of God. We want Christ to be in your home. We want your home controlled and governed and dominated by the fear of God. We don't want anybody to be lost. We want everybody to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Father, today we thank you today. We confess our faults, our shortcomings, our imperfections. Lord, we confess the things that we have done ignorantly through unbelief. Lord, we have rejected you in the past, many of us have. But Lord, we turn to you because we know that those that reject Christ, those that live a life of pleasure, those that give in to their flesh, those that live outside of the will of God, those that disobey God and come short of his glory, that they are fighting a losing fight. Father, today, give them that desire to turn from their wicked way, turn from their sins. Father, in Jesus' name, Jesus came that we might have life. He came to eradicate. He came to eradicate all unrighteousness from our lives. Father, in Jesus' name, we pray. Come into my soul. Come into my heart. Put in me a desire to live for me, but for you. Lord, put in me a desire to turn away from my pleasures and to live a lifestyle that's going to be contrary to what you have already commanded us to do. Father, in Jesus' name, come in, come in, come in, and make me what you want me to be. Make me that vessel of honor. Make me a channel that you can flow through. Make me, Lord, an instrument of righteousness. Oh God, I confess my sins. I've sinned and come short. I've disobeyed you in the past. I've lived contrary to your word. But today I'm coming home. Today I'm coming home. I'm coming home. Father, we thank you right now in Jesus' name. Everybody repeat with me. Lord, wash me.
Lord, wash me.
From all of my sins.
From all my sins.
Cleanse me.
Cleanse me.
From all of my imperfections.
All of my imperfections.
Set me free.
Set me free.
Make me all you want me to be.
Help me.
Help me.
To fear you.
To fear you. And to walk before you.
And to walk before you.
With all of my heart.
With all my heart.
All the days of my life. I'm turning to you.
In faith.
In faith.
In faith.
In faith.
Trusting you.
Trusting you.
Trusting in your blood.
To cleanse me.
To wash me.
To purge me.
From all my iniquities.
I give you praise and glory.
I receive you.
I turn to you.
I rededicate my life to you.
In Jesus' name.
Help me
to be strong in the Lord
and in the power of his might.
Father, we give you praise and glory.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. We're going to have a scripture reading. We're going to have a scripture reading. And after the scripture reading, we're going to admonish you to follow the directions as to the partaking of the Lord's Supper. Hallelujah.
seal of the Lord in which also I delivered unto you.
Yes.
That the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." Let us eat the broken body. After the same manner also, he took the cup. And when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Let us drink. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. The church say amen.
Amen.
Oh,
with you all. Everybody said.